I'm Reynolds Price. I'm in Fort Worth, Texas, at the 9th Van Cliburn International Piano Competition. The 35 young pianists who have gathered here from around the world for 2 full weeks of keyboard performance will aim whole lifetimes of thought and practice in pursuit of the eloquence that wins gold, silver, and bronze medals and launches them perhaps on long careers in the service of music. We'll watch and hear these gifted contenders as they work to recreate in us some sense of the high exuberance to which they've committed so much of their lives. And while any sympathetic witness can guess at the degree of elation which has powered their years of effort, no one but they can measure the weight of sacrifice which has brought them here. They have, in a real sense, prepared their whole lives for such a moment. In its rigor, the competition will extract from some displays of skill and mastery which are perhaps the finest of their young lives. In other cases, even extraordinarily gifted young artists will discover that now a large public career of the sort being promised and sketched out here is not for them. The drama, obviously, which arises from those two polar possibilities, is part of the excitement of what we're about to see.
When you hear somebody who is creative, who sees things that they're unusual, that you haven't even seen it, because everybody of us knows what the piece is and knows it even better than as we can play it, because we all have an ideal picture of a piece. But then comes along somebody who is original, somebody who has something to say, that there comes a performance where you are afraid to lose one word because the ideas that are announced are so interesting and important.
I'm looking for physiognomy, a personality, a face in the playing. I look also for intensity of communication.
I love music, and I would love to meet another lover. I don't want to meet another player. That's what I love and look for, that there comes someone along who will turn a phrase of a composer, and I can feel that he found for himself. This is his treasure, and he shares it with me. Then I will love him because he has given me something that I don't have without him.
fare quello che riusciva a fare Arthur
Rubinstein. He says this may be a dream for me, but I would like to do what Arthur Rubinstein did, that he, when he played as if he were playing to you. He made you feel like there was nobody else in the room, and that's a dream of his. Ha detto se per te non era un rischio venire qui.
Infatti yes, io fino all'ultimo non volevo venire.
He, no, he didn't want to come until the very last minute. But his Berman, his teacher, said he was always very doubtful that he should go because he didn't, you know, really know. It wasn't, well, it's never sure, but it was a big risk.
The prime question is, why have this many human beings chosen to come to Fort Worth, Texas, and submit themselves to the degree of pressure, of grueling labor, and the potential for personal rejection that each one of the competitors must agree to face in entering such an event? Why would any sane person want to do this?
The publicity that you can receive from this competition is the biggest in the world. I mean, if you play well, if you play bad, you can close the piano and go home and stop playing the piano, because everybody will know that you played badly in the Van Cliver, so it's very dangerous to play in this competition.
Aside from the aspects of personality and creativity, is individuality. Yeah, I mean, that aspect that sets one apart, you know, the magic of the moment.
Once he reaches me, I assume that he will reach an audience. And it is interesting, too, that you hear immediately when someone plays with a sympathy for a composer or a love for that composer, that his whole playing takes on a different dimension or a different feeling, that his hands touch the keyboard and the keyboard responds.
To me, the most important thing, and I think for every good performer, the most important thing is to be a link. Link, is it, does it work? Between composer and audience. So you must forget about yourself. You try just to make people understanding what this guy wanted to say when he was writing this work.
First of all, I don't play Mozart. I play very little Beethoven. Bach I play, but not in public. So it's, you know, if we had been required to do the classical, you know, Prelude and Fugue of Bach, Mozart Sonata, and then early Beethoven or you know, and then late Beethoven, Schubert Sonata, whatever, you know, that the typical routine, I certainly wouldn't have done it. came with the idea of kind of provoking the jury into making kind of a philosophical decision whether they were going to accept this kind of playing and this kind of idea about music or not. But I think there should be a lot more enjoyment, a lot more fun for the competition.
Everybody chooses what pieces fits them.
I chose a kind of repertoire that I think show me really like I feel I am like a pianist and a musician.
I have a particularly exotic fruit of pomegranate or something to compare with all the others.
It's more difficult to play deep music, deep things. I like to play this.
I really wanted to play pieces that I hope people will enjoy rather than feel bothered because they're so difficult to listen to or they're so long and people are worried that technically it's so difficult a program, you know. I didn't want to feel that, so I picked a really easy first preliminary program because that's all I thought I'll be playing.
I'm not coming back.
What are you gonna do?
Go home, cry, sleep, whatever.
We don't have many concerts in Armenia because it was very cold, sometimes in our room, winter about five degrees. It's very cold. And sometimes I practice with kerosene heater. I tried to study in Moscow Conservatory about 4 years ago, but they say I don't know history of party. So it was very terrible for me.
come here and to find again that in an immersion in this much music in this short a space, to find that its possibilities of excitement and revelation are still intact, and that they are being offered to us by artists of the youngest imaginable generation to have achieved this much skill is certainly consoling when so many other traditional joys of the human race seem fatally imperiled. This music in these hands seems safe for another round of human lifetimes at the very least. I suppose we can't ask for greater guarantees than that.
Sometimes I get nervous that the audience may be dwindling. I don't know if that's myth. There's probably no way of measuring it, but if the audience dwindles too much, you know, it won't matter who's a good pianist, who's a bad pianist, and there won't be any audience. And I remember once running into a friend on the street, and we both had Walkmans on, and he said, "What are you listening to?" And I could hear his rap, you know, through the earphones, but he said, "What are you listening to?" I said, "Chopin." He said, "Well, I've got nothing against Chopin, and he's fine, but he's dead."
He says, you have to look at the past, but not only look at the past, because we're the future.
Gli altri compositori hanno già fatto il nostro futuro, noi dobbiamo fare un altro.
The past composers have made a future for us, now we have to make a future for the coming generation. Beautiful.
There's a big part of our society today, I think, that goes to a concert with the expectation of being excited, and I use this word cautiously, but nonetheless, I think it's fact, entertained.
Yeah.
It's become part of our whole society's way.
Because, you see, in
rather than that nasty word, educate.
It is not only that they are being taught something, but that they have to be wide open. They come 50%.
The art won't die. They'll just stop going to and miss out on a whole dimension of greatness.
Was it Nietzsche who said life without music is total he said Unsinn, meaning it makes no sense.
Pianist is not everything. You have to be a musician, you have to be, in the future, you have to be an artist. I had to open my ears, my eyes, you know, my heart, you know, my mind to everything, because before I just thought if you practiced really hard, you know, you can be a good pianist. I'm from Oriental background where you know, everything is all set up and everything is kind of computerized in your mind. And when I first came to him for about 2-3 years, I had to memorize 20 English vocabularies every lesson. And I had to write papers, you know, essays on many different subjects.
The piano teacher needs to know 4 things. Bonjour, mademoiselle. A little too fast, a little too much pedal. Give my regards to your mama. You know, that's, you know. And I remember meeting English professors, you know, Albert. And they thought teaching piano was some sort of rudimentary, something like typing, you know. But in fact, it goes around everything, and it has no limits.
Too beautiful, it was too refined before. But that's the danger, you know, when you go into such situations, one wants to put the best foot forward, but it's really the worst foot which is the more interesting foot, because the best foot is the same with everybody, and there are many feet like that. But your worst foot is the individual and the personal side of you.
Did you put your best foot forward or your worst foot forward?
Yeah, worst foot, definitely worst foot.
I've been, anyway, very nervous today. I don't know why.
I would like to do it again if I could.
Yeah. Nothing could make me uncomfortable unless I am unprepared.
It's funny being out there, you know? It's different. It's, you think, oh, you know, it's just another competition. But once you're out there and you have all these flags, you're going, oops, I'm on the Clyburn stage right now, and I think I should be playing really well.
And in performance of the great works, we're in it for life.
Seeing these young faces, I try to imagine the cold terror that some of them must be feeling. And I realize that along with the dreams these brave interpretive artists have, they must also endow themselves with a brute recklessness and courage in order to consider facing every day an audience of sharks who could potentially consume them.
Fort Worth has been privileged to hear 35 gorgeous recitals. They were magnificent. When I go hear a performance that's wonderful, I feel inspired and I want to go home and practice. And every time I've heard each and every one of you, I've wanted to practice. I applaud you for giving all of us such a thrill and such joy, happiness, and satisfaction. Thank you.
As I read your name, please come on stage, receive your certificate from Van, and please remain on stage. Andrew Armstrong.
I wasn't nervous only because I didn't have any control over it, so.
Armin Babakani.
I'm happy.
Fabio Bidini. Frederick Chu. Valerie Kulishoff. Alexander Melnikov. Shirley Xiaomi Pan. Simone Pedroni. Richard Ramon.
Well, we never know what to expect in competition.
Veronika Reznikovskaya. Johann Schmidt.
Always a very good surprise because the level is so high. Especially in this competition, I think.
Christopher Taylor.
I like to do something different so the judges at least remember who I am.
Ladies and gentlemen, these are your 12 semifinalists. Please remain on stage for photo.
My first time ever that I've got knocked out in the first round. Well, I first called and then he said, so? And I think he expected at least that I would go into the semifinals. And I said, when I told him I didn't, and there was silence, you know, there was no talk for a while. And I think he was even a little bit surprised because I studied with him for such a long time. But, you know, he said not to worry and just to continue, and that's life.
Yeah. Moscow, 1958, the first Tchaikovsky piano competition. Van Cliburn stuns the world and is awarded the gold medal by Dmitri Shostakovich. He returns home not only a musician, but a hero who proved that even in the darkest days of the Cold War, music was possessed with the power to touch us all with a common chord. What's your sense of how we're going to proceed to transmit this information, this big gift from one generation to the next?
Yes, well, in 385 BC, when Plato established the Academy of Learning at Athens, he knew very well that music, because of its ethereal and invisible qualities, had the great sway over the human soul. And he also said that music was the highest form of mathematics. While mathematical, it was also spiritual, so it ennobled the soul.
This art of giving solo recitals and concerts, which were started by Liszt and Paganini, is somehow dying now. I certainly have this feeling everywhere, in Russia, in Germany, here in the United States as well. I'm sure that classical music can't die, but this art of these concerts, you know, because when Liszt started it, I think it was new and everybody was so affected with it. And then, the time is changing, it's always like that.
Okay, thank you very much. It was very good. You were just perfect now, that's fantastic. Now, what...
The best thing humanity ever created is art. To me, it's religions and art.
No, that was too short.
Okay.
Yeah, again. this easier than to play solo because you are supported by someone. On the other hand, it's more difficult than solo because you have to be very careful to the others. You have to not only listen to what you are doing, but what altogether, what how it sounds like.
What I want to do is to really keep it going.
Okay. Yeah.
Why I feel that chamber music is very, very important. And in a pianist competition, especially in a pianist competition. Because to show the manifold sides of a pianist, of a musician, who is not trained like a parrot for one program, getting the octave a little faster or the trill a little faster, but is using what he does in the music in order to reveal music. I think the reason, basically, that I have a little problem with chamber music is that I look upon the making of chamber music almost as a marriage. And I think that it takes the development that takes place in a marriage and works.
You forgot for God's sake.
Chamber music in a fixed group is that of a marriage. Chamber music with other groups is that of a love affair. You meet another musician, you have a communication or you don't. You have sympathy or you don't. And you feel that immediately. But what you do have sympathy for is a Schumann quartet, a Brahms quintet, a Schumann quintet, a César, a Dvorak quintet. You have moments in which you express the language of Dvorak as close as you can get to him. Ta-di-da-da, ta-da-di. What a beautiful heaven, heaven.
Quando c'è accordo.
He says when we have an accord, then it's sufficient.
It's
and
a
we
feeling,
do.
It's yeah, feeling.
Yeah, 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 it's a feeling. And I agree, I have to tell you.
Thank you.
so I do feel, while we see them on clouds, not always on cloud nine, we can see them for a moment close to heaven.
Well, I mean, there have been times thus far in the chamber music that we've heard here. There have been one or two who show precisely what it is you're speaking of. I mean, their ability immediately to interact and to make it happen very well. We're looking in that instance for where the pianist's mind is, their musical mind, their musical personality, in terms of, are you able to do this rather than to be the soloist?
And yet, at the same time, always have the composer in mind.
Of course, well, that's a given. It's a given.
Now, this whole opening section, the way I played it, was too loud. It should be, but I don't have that kind of control. It should be the way so many of you played it. Very, you can hardly hear it. It should be, you know, really.
I would think that the great challenge in a piece like Ghost Waltzes is to be absolutely certain that the interpreters go off on an errand of self-discovery.
And then here, of course,
what is it in their own life that lies back there in the way that this piece does for Morton Gould? Anyone who has brought his body to the peak of skill that's required in this competition must surely have ghost waltzes all along the road of his life.
This is where this comes from, you see. This is the play of the things that my mother sang to me when she sang lullaby waltzes.
Well, I know exactly what the ghost waltz of my childhood was. It was the night when my father, at that time a man of about 36 years old, came into my little bedroom where I slept alone in an iron crib. Came in with talcum powder in his hair and stood by my crib in the half dark and sang, "When I grow too old to dream, I'll have you to remember." I think maybe that's even a waltz. And I was suddenly amazed and frightened. What's happened to my father? He's suddenly old.
I have always been hearing in one form or another, or reminded of, the very first music that I ever heard when I was a baby growing up, and my parents had to play a piano. And the music that I heard was on the piano rolls, you know, so I heard pianola sounds. They became embedded in me and part of my memory. So that was my atmosphere. And what I'm taking now is the atmosphere of my past, the musical atmosphere, and restructuring it into my own creative image now, many, many, many years later, as a collage of all these different influences. This is now, I got so frenetic I lost it. I mean, this is what's called losing one's marbles, you see, and there the performer should do the same. Fades, and then one final flurry. And the last three chords are the waltz rhythm. Bum, bum, bum. And that's it. And now, hopefully, all the ghosts are laid to rest.
What's it been like to listen to 12 premieres of Ghost Waltzes in 1 week?
12 times is a lot of times for me to hear it, even if it's my own piece. Each one, in their own different ways, reveal things about the piece that I was not aware of. I thought, hey, I didn't know that was there, that was in it. Because every performer has his or her own kind of chemistry.
The reason I play this music is because I feel great when I work on it, when I look at it, and I see that such perfection in the writing. You know, there are pieces where you couldn't change one single note. I want people to feel kind of the same way that I feel when I work on these pieces. image that classical music has is terrible. And this started, you know, way, way back. It's, you know, from the 30s and 40s, composers and the public just kind of went their separate ways.
Well, you're calm and feeling good and not too hungry.
Oh no, not hungry at all. In fact, I still got a bit of that egg.
Egg right here.
I still feel it. It hasn't gone down quite yet.
I've had lots of phone calls about you this morning.
Yeah?
Yes. From? Everybody wants to come get tickets for your performance, all of our friends.
Yeah.
And there are no tickets.
Good
point. You know, you've got a fan club. I mean, they're all standing in line to see you and touch you.
Okay, I'm ready.
Is all about really, isn't it? Doing something different.
Doing something different, yeah. No.
That's the way you lead your life? Why? No.
Because I think it's kind of boring to do the same things over and over, at least for me.
Today, with all the things that are available, radio, recordings, there is such an ease in which we could transmit many of the things that very often before would have been forgotten, only remembered by the ones who heard it and then followed it, so to speak, imitated it. The only thing is that they must then discover for themselves what it is that you feel it. You can't imitate a feeling. You can hear someone who has felt deeply, but you must create that feeling within you.
The great English poet John Keats, who, alas, died at the age of 26. Keats says in a letter of his something which has always felt like a kind of motto for my life, and especially my life as a writer. He says, the excellence of every art is its intensity. I'm out the door fast. If that intensity is not there, why bother to spend the evening with...
Exactly.
And a lot of younger people would think we're being much too intense about
feeling.
What they would call feeling, yeah. But it seems to me it's about all we've got.
I think that is what kept the world going, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Feeling for the beauty that has been created, feeling for one another. Feeling is a very important aspect. And why not as an artist? What I would say for a young person, you should always feel, I'm going to say it better than it has been said before, because he has discovered it for himself.
Music is the language of the soul of the human being.
our society is needed. I mean, everything is very dry and very modern, and I think classical music can bring a lot of things to especially young people, I mean.
I try to compete against myself. I mean, just let the music be in my body and my soul and my brain. So I try to forget the competition. I mean, it's more easy to say than to do, but that's what I keep trying.
My advice would be
learning to practice and figuring out how one learns a piece of music. I think that's a difficult skill to learn. I was always amazed how I would come out of the lesson playing better than I came into it, and not really knowing how it happened.
That's what the teacher's job is to always point to this fundamental motivation and this great glory and glamour of exploring the universe and exploring the inner nature simultaneously.
I guess he views me sort of as the crusading medieval knight in some ways, as you know, crusading for my causes, my Bachs and my Boulezes. I think audiences are certainly ready for a change. There have been enough Kleiman competitions, there have been enough Tchaikovsky competitions now that people are getting pretty familiar with the old standbys, the ballades and the Tchaikovsky concerti and so forth. I mean, much as they love that music, I think they are perhaps ready to have their horizons expanded.
That is a lucky troll.
I hope he will help us. He smiled very nice. That's helped me. He's here, must help Valery.
I first met Valery Kuleshov in 1987 at the Busoni International Piano Competition in Bolzano, Italy. He was interesting to me because he had played a Horowitz transcription. And these transcriptions were never written down by Horowitz and therefore never published. So I went up to him and said, well, how did you manage this? And of course the answer was, he listened maybe 100 times or more to the recordings of Horowitz and memorized this very intricate music.
Thomas Frost was at that competition, and he sent to Vladimir Horowitz my tape.
I knew that they were pretty close to what they should be in terms of all the notes being there, so I took the chance and said, do you want to hear this young man? He said, yes.
We had the tickets, and we just wait for taxi to go to airport, and exactly at that time Thomas Frost probably sent a fax that I must a little bit wait in Moscow, but I thought that probably it will be better to wait in New York. After 1 hour I had another fax. I really must stay in Moscow and wait. And in the next day, Vladimir Horowitz was died.
That was the end of the story, as far as Valery is concerned. He never got the opportunity.
I think when one's in the midst of any group of young contenders, whether they're Olympic athletes or competitors in an international piano competition, one thinks fairly rapidly of Cocteau's reference to artists as monstres sacrés, as sacred monsters. Who on earth, in his right mind, would choose to test his body and his mind in a forum where there were so many opportunities for disappointment? Yet watching these sacred monsters, I felt largely elation, regret for some, deep sympathy for others. But mostly I felt the same tremendous excitement that most of them seemed to feel as they demonstrated before our eyes the pitch of human possibility.
Thank you.
I'm very tired. I'm very tired. But I'm happy. I'm happy because I can play what I want.
If you could have all 35 or the 12 semifinalists or the finalists in this room with us now, is there a core of advice you'd want to give them?
If they need any advice, I would certainly praise them for having the courage to do a competition such as this, to have survived all the hazards that surround having to come out on that stage and know that this is it. In our field, you can get mugged. You can get mugged by an audience or by a whole auditorium of people. You can get mugged critically. And when you get a good write-up, that doesn't mean you're going to get it the next time. All I could say to them would be, good luck. Don't let anybody get you down.
A friend of mine who's an English poet said to me, you must remember one thing. If you do your work, there will be people who love you for exactly the same reason that other people hate you. And it's a very valuable thing to hear.
What we have to find is our own truth. Who are we?
You're a wonderfully gifted pianist. Just very, very beautiful. I sat amongst the 12 expectant semifinalists and thought at great length about similar moments in my own early 20s when I set challenges for myself that ultimately seemed suicidal and wondered why I'd done so. But I also felt a tremendous sense of stability and real sanity in these candidates. They had displayed, for better or for worse, what they had. I heard no syllable of apology from any of them, and they left me with the feeling that their self-possession bespoke a wonderful dignity, a genuine pride in what they had just achieved before our eyes.
All of you have earned for yourselves many new fans and admirers. Your playing has touched so many people, and there were so many wonderful anecdotes of people who intensely liked certain of you and will follow you and your careers all the rest of your lives. I am very grateful to each and every one of you, and I shall be following your careers with the deepest interest all the rest of my life. Thank you.
I will now read the six finalists. Armin Babakanian. Fabio Guidini. Valery Kuleshov. Simone Pedroni. Johann Schmidt. Christopher Taylor. These six young men will perform Thursday, Friday, and Saturday evening with the Fort Worth Chamber Orchestra and the Fort Worth Symphony under the baton of Maestro Jerzy Semkov. Please be there.
If I were a manager, I would be interested only in Chu. He will have a career and a good one. So that's, and I guess the jury didn't think I had, they thought I had not displayed a sense of musical architecture. That's kind of strange. New York Times, I don't think this has really sunk in yet how important this is.
I am receiving in the newspaper every day section politics, life, sports. And nothing dedicated or almost nothing dedicated to culture, to some humanistic values and so forth. Nobody is born, nobody appears in this world with the formed and ready sense of aesthetics, of beauty. Yeah. That must be formed. That you receive home from your parents, from the school, from television. And I believe that you are, first of all, you are promoting sports rather than what we can call the sense of beauty.
If you could change one thing, can you think of anything that would make a big difference?
If I could change something in this world, I will change two things. I will abolish the nuclear weapons and something that you call backbeat, you see.
Мне очень нравится здесь особенно, что дома стоит большой Steinway.
He's very happy to have a Steinway at home here. He can practice. When Valery practice here at night time, about 11 o'clock in the evening, nobody said to him, oh, stop it, please, it's too late, or something like that. But in Moscow, at our apartments, it is absolutely impossible. He can play just until 9 o'clock in the evening, and after that our neighbors start to bam 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 bam.
These contestants must walk out onto the stage with the best semblance of the buccaneer spirit that the romantic pianist can manage, and play as their final entry before judgment one of the great pieces of the classical piano tradition. They know who's out there. They know that beyond tonight, millions of people will see them on television. Why are they doing it? Why do they dare?
They bring it off. I suppose the satisfaction will be enormous.
Thank you.
Как ты чувствуешь себя сейчас?
Ну, сейчас лучше, да. Сейчас лучше.
Now he feels a little bit better because all over.
I tried to play always better than last time, and it's always more difficult. But if you play in a good way and you are in the final without the first prize, but you are second or third prize, doesn't mean that you are not able to play the piano. You have to be happy. If I play in a way that I'm not happy after that, I don't care anymore about the prize, I don't care anymore about the competition. Because I'm here and I compete against myself, I don't compete against other pianists here.
As each of the finalists makes his way through this last and most grueling round of the competition, he's likely to find, at the end of his effort, a tremendously enthusiastic response from this large and very diverse audience. It's partly, of course, a response to his daring and to the success with which he's met the risks he posed for himself. But even sweeter for him, I would think, would be the realization that this response comes largely because he has recreated one of the great pieces of piano music,
and made that moment incandescent and memorable for thousands of strangers.
It's very important, very, very great for me when audience love me, and I love audience also. It's wonderful contact with audience. It's very important for all pianists.
Music is our life. I mean, even if I add any concert, I will practice 10 hours a day because it's my kind of express my personality, my soul. Even if I had any concert, I will play and play again until the last day of my life.
apparently a decent sale for a classical CD in this country is somewhere between 5,000 and 8,000 copies. Anything we can or should do about that incredibly small percentage of people who seem to be moved by certain things in this enormously large country?
I think we need to combat the sort of fossilized image that I think classical music may be acquiring. And I suppose that's sort of part of my message. One needs to bring in fresh insights, and I think that's pretty much as we performers can do. But it is certainly paradoxical how the standard repertoire is sort of staying in one place, and so it is receding into the past as we move forward. As for whether classical music is going to be lost and we'll be stuck with rock and roll or whatever, I guess I like to remain optimistic.
It's really been an amazing experience because I've never really been as closely associated or identified with a real deep personality, and we've had a rapprochement, such a close association. It's really strange that I've done some things for this guy that I haven't done for my own children. On the piano, he played the Yellow Rose of Texas. I said, you must do that after you do your Chopin.
No.
The Yellow Rose of Texas will bring the house down.
Classic.
Yes.
Classic, only classic.
The Yellow Rose of Texas is classic. Yeah. I've switched from Mylan to Tagamet, and I made it.
Van Cliburn winning the gold medal at the Tchaikovsky competition in 1958 was catapulted into an international career, perhaps unprecedented since that of Franz Liszt. What will come of the medalist at this competition? Will a medal prove a blight or a token of greater hope? Only the individual performer can discover that. Though it's legitimate in us as watchers and well-wishers to hope that each of them and all those who are not bemedaled can proceed with one of the best kinds of human life, a life in music.
All people are the same the world over, and all people need beauty, inspiration, art, great music, the things that make life truly valuable.
The winner of the sixth prize, Fabio Bidini. Winner of the fifth prize, Armin Babakanian. The winner of fourth prize is Johann Schmidt. The bronze medal, winner of the ninth Van Cliburn International Competition, the third prize goes to Christopher Taylor. Approach this next with understandable trepidation, because in a sense I cannot announce one winner without announcing two. I'll do my best. The second prize, it also includes the silver medal. It carries with it a $10,000 cash award. The silver medal winner of the ninth Van Cliburn International Competition, Valery Kuleshov. The first prize, cash award $15,000. And a recital at New York's Carnegie Hall. Ladies and gentlemen, may I present to you the gold medal winner of the ninth Van Cliburn International Competition, Simone Padroni.
Chagas, eh? Muchas gracias.
Viste che ce l'hai fatta tutta.
Good luck.
I'm tired.
Exhausted. I'm done.
Pronto? Elisa? Aspetta.
A me mi trema tutto.
He's trembling all over, he says.